In this lesson, we will talk about one of the most famous problems and algorithms in computer science, how to find the shortest path in a graph. You may have heard about Dijkstra's algorithm. This is the algorithm that we will be discussing. It is covered in section 4.4 of our textbook. I would like to take just a minute to tell you a few things about Dijkstra. He was one of the most influential computer scientists, of course one of the first computer scientists too, and I suggest you read this Wikipedia article. It says quite a bit about his research and his life. Dijkstra is also known for his many quotes and aphorisms that have become famous over the years. One main thing that he believed in was that programming is not just writing code, but it's very important that you actually prove the correctness of your code. He famously said that if you just try to argue about the correctness of your code by testing, you just show the presence of bugs. You can never be certain that they are absent. So he had this idealistic view of programming as an art that can also be a science. So here is the problem we're trying to solve. We're given a graph. It may be either directed, as you see here, or it may be undirected. Obviously, if it is undirected, you can turn it into directed by replacing every undirected edge with two directed edges. The other thing that you're given is for every edge, you have a length or a cost of that edge, which is non-negative. So think of these lengths as the distance from one node to the other. If you are given a certain source, let's say this node here, your goal is to compute, first of all, the smallest distance, the minimum distance from the source to every other node. So if we have, for instance, this node, let's call it target, we're trying to find out what is the path that will give us the minimum distance, the minimum sum of the corresponding link costs that will take us from S to T. In this case, of course, this path goes from S to 2, to 3, to 5, to T. The total cost of this path is 50. And if you try to find a path that has a smaller cost than that, you will see that it doesn't exist. Together with the minimum distance from the source to every other node, you also want to find the actual path. You want to find the sequence of nodes that will take you from S to T. I want to emphasize here that the fact that the link costs are non-negative is very important. We will see later that the algorithm doesn't work, actually, if the link costs are negative. And finally, I want to say that if we didn't have these link costs, if all the links had a cost of 1 or the same cost, then obviously we would be able to solve this problem using the breadth-first search algorithm. So what makes this a little bit more interesting is that the costs can be arbitrary as long as they are non-negative. This problem is very common in practice. You can think of applications such as routing a packet through the internet where you may have links, transmission links with different costs, using something like Google Maps to find the best route to go from one place to another. There are literally thousands of applications of the shortest path problem. Now, instead of just presenting the algorithm, Dijkstra's shortest path algorithm, let's look at an example and try to essentially rediscover the algorithm ourselves. So imagine that we have this directed graph, and this is our source node. And as you see, we have the cost of every edge. How would you start? I mean, clearly, we don't know anything yet. The only thing that we do know is that the smallest distance to go from S to itself is zero, so we can keep track of that. And for all the other nodes, we are not certain yet what is the minimum distance. So we can symbolically represent that by writing that the smallest distance we know so far for each of these nodes is infinite, right? So We can start introducing some notation here. We say that d of v, so d of v is the minimum distance that we have from the source to node v up to that point in the algorithm's execution. And initially this distance is set to infinity for all the nodes except the source, for which we can be certain that the distance is zero. Is there any node at this point in time for which we can be certain about its minimum distance from the source? We know that the source is connected directly with these three other nodes. So clearly we can find the neighbor that has the smallest distance from the source. In this case, it is node 2. This edge gives us a new distance for the node 2. The question I have now is, can we be certain at this point that this is the minimum distance from the source to node 2? Is there any way that we could have reached node 2 through another path that has a smaller cost than this direct cost here? You can see that it's not possible actually to find a path from the source to node 2 at a smaller distance than this. Why? Because any other such path would have to go through an edge that has a larger cost than 9. Remember, we picked this particular neighbor because it had the edge with the minimum cost. So if we try to reach node 2 through any other path, we would definitely introduce a larger cost. Now that we know that the distance to node 2 is 9, we can also update the distances to the neighbors of 2. So the neighbor of 2 is node 3. We can set it to 33. Why? Because the distance from S to 2 is 9, and the distance from 2 to 3 is 24. So I'm introducing some additional notation here. So this set S includes for which we have already discovered the minimum distance from S. Gradually, we would like this set to include all of the nodes in the graph. But at this point, it only includes the nodes that are in this blue shaded part of the graph. So the algorithm now starts becoming more and more clear. We're maintaining the variable, the set S, all the nodes for which we have already computed the minimum cost from the source. So we're kind of done with those nodes. And for all the other nodes, we're maintaining a variable d, which keeps track of the smallest distance we know so far from the source to the corresponding node. So at this point here, we have explored the nodes 0 and 2. For them, we already know what is the minimum distance from the source. And for all the other nodes, we have a working estimate of the distance from the source based on what we know so far. So for node 3, at this point, we know how to get there with a distance of 33. For node 6, we can get there with a distance of 14. And for node 7, we can get there with a distance of 15. So in every iteration of the algorithm, we pick the one node that has the smallest distance from the source, one of the nodes that we have not already covered, in this case node 6. We include this node in our set S, the set of explored nodes, and we also have to update the distances for the rest of the nodes. So as you see here, we can now reach node 3 with a distance of 32. We can reach node 5 with a distance of not infinite but 44, which is 14 plus 30, and this distance hasn't changed. So I will show the rest of the animation a bit more quickly without explaining everything. So here, the next node we pick is node 7. It has the smallest distance to the source. And the next one will be node 3. The next one will be node 5. Don't forget, in every step of this iteration, we are also updating the distances to the rest of the nodes. These updates can only decrease the distance to a node. They can never increase the distance to a node. So then we get to node 4, and finally we see that node 5 is reachable with a distance of 50. So here is the algorithm. As I said before, we maintain a set S for all the nodes for which we already have the shortest distance from the source. And we maintain this variable D for every node. This is the minimum distance we have so far for that node. Initially, of course, we only have that distance for the source equal to 0. And for all the other nodes, initially, the distance is infinite. And in every iteration of the loop, we add one node, the node U, into the set of explored nodes. Initially, of course, U is the source. And then for every neighbor of U that is not already in the set of explored nodes, let's say V, we check to see whether the distance that we already have for that node is larger or smaller than the distance through U. So if we can reach V through U, that means that that path will have a distance of d of u, which is, we already know that this is the smallest distance to reach u, plus the cost of the edge from u to v. So if this distance is smaller than the distance that we previously knew for v, then we update this distance and we remember that we can reach V through U. So this variable here, prev, means previous, right? Now, after we do this update for every neighbor of U that is not already explored, we pick the next unexplored node with the minimum distance, and we make that the node that we will then add to the set S. I want you to see here that this variable prev, right, is useful in order to find the actual path from the source to the target. So if this is the target, for instance, at the end of this algorithm's execution, we will also know what is the previous node in the path from S to T. So let's say, for instance, that this is V, right? For V, similarly, we will know that the previous node to reach V is U. Similarly, for U, we will know the previous node to reach U. It may be, for instance, this node here. Let's call it W, right? And for W, we will similarly know that the previous node to reach W is S. So by starting from the target and going backwards, following these variables prev of every node, we can discover essentially the reverse of the path, the shortest path from the source to the target.